Lake Placid, the venue for the 1932 and 1980 Winter Olympic Games in the Adirondack Mountains of upstate New York. And there is the venue for the Miracle on Ice, one of the greatest winter sport achievements in U.S. Olympic sporting history. Well, we've seen plenty of excitement here on this track as well. We're getting ready for more as we get into the second heat, the deciding run of the season opener of the two-man bobsleigh World Cup. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back. I'm Martin Haven, and alongside me is Olympic American slider Kurt Tomasevich. Kurt, this Lake Placid track, it's going to be really tight. We've got such a tough field coming up. Ice conditions are about as perfect as you can get. Nice couple of degrees below zero. Precious little wind. And nice, smooth, fast conditions for the drivers.
Yeah, it's cooled down just a little bit, a couple degrees colder than the first heat. A lot of times that means a little harder ice. And we could see sleds actually go faster in the second heat than they do in the first heat, which isn't always the case.
See the jury members in the foreground checking the temperature of the runners against the control steel. Our first heat, well, we have German rookie Francesco Friedrich really putting the cat amongst the pigeons, comfortably quicker than teammates Max Arndt and Manuel Mahata. He lies in fourth position after the first run, from second down to 10th place. 0.2 seconds covers half the field. Third spot, US slider Nick Cunningham. Both he and Corey Butler in fifth position, having really good first runs. And that is just a reflection of how strong they've been training here, Kurt.
Yeah, Nick is usually does a little bit better in four-man than he does in two-man. But sitting in third place right now, he's really excited.
I bet he is. It's the start beasts, Oscars Melbanis and Damans Driskins for Latvia, who not only put in an epic start, but a really good run to take second position. They lead the chasing pack. But in a separate class of his own, the Olympic and world champion Steve Holcomb, with Stephen Langton behind him, leading here by over 0.3 seconds. And it's hard to imagine Holkey giving that kind of advantage away. In fact, it's over 0.4 seconds he has in hand.
Yeah, it's been a while since Holcomb's lost a heat on this track, let alone a race. So, you know, using that new sled that he just brought out for this race, he's pretty excited too.
Well, Holcomb leads by 0.45, but look behind, from second Melbardis to 10th, 0.2 seconds. And there's just as tight little battles going on all the way down the 20 fast sleds. 27 started this afternoon, 20 go into the second and deciding heat. You can see lots of friends and family and fans up at the top of the track. The start area is always a great place to be, so full of naked aggression and adrenaline. Here's our start list. They go in reverse order of their first heat performance, last to fast. And Jürgen Lewacka of Austria tied with Jan Werber of the Czech Republic. They'll be the first two sleds off the hill. Steve Holcomb will wait the better part of an hour before he gets his next run in. And that will hopefully for him be a valedictory performance. But before then, we expect to see an awful lot of change. We've got a few ties in the top 20 and some tiny gaps between the other sleds.
Now clear from the finish to start number one. Start one.
It's a still, cool, overcast afternoon here on Mount Van Hovenberg as we get ready for the deciding run in the season opener of the two-man bobsleigh World Cup. Jürgen Lewacka with Matthias Adolf on the back of the Austrian sled. And Lewacka tied for 19th spot, 1.15 seconds off the lead. But again, looking to move up after not the greatest first run. Kurt Tomasevich, he's got to try and just tidy up his act.
Yeah, and that's going to start right here with improving their start time. They were 23rd best start time in the first heat, 5:34. This heat, again, same thing, 5:34. So he's going to really try to do better tomorrow in the four-man race. And that's where Jürgen usually does a little bit better. Hopefully just hold on to the top few places here.
Well, his predecessor in the Austrian team, Wolfgang Stampfer, was very much the same. Great pair of hands, really talented driver, but with the four-man with three extra bodies hefting the sled, always seemed to be more competitive with that. Looking here to try and gauge his speed. Nice, smooth lines. Tap.
Jürgen has had some success here in the past, got a fifth place here in 2009 that set him up for the Olympics in 2010. But since then, two-man just really hasn't been his strong point.
23.9 is not bad speed. That's pretty middling for the field. see Steve Holcomb at the end of the race going a lot quicker than that. 56.77, 600ths of a second slower than his first heat. So maybe slightly different mistakes. You tidy one up, another one pops out somewhere else. The start was identical. The downtime nearly identical. Not a bad run through the chicane, though, Kurt.
Yeah, not bad. You can see him just look over the front of the cowl, and you can't see the brakeman at all. And that's a sign of a good riding position, way down low in the back end of the sled. You want to be very aerodynamic. And as we talked about in the first heat, just kind of become part of the sled.
And there's Jürgen. And to not be able to see Matthias Loacker, that's a good Matthias Adolf. He's 6'5", so including the crew, the sled weighs no more than 390 kilos. We had a problem with that with one of our Russian sleds. They were disqualified for being overweight. Of course, the theory is that if you hurl a snowball down this hill and hurl a bowling ball down the hill, we all know which one gets to the bottom first, right?
Exactly.
And that's why there's a maximum weight limit as well as a minimum for safety. Well, Loacker, our race leader there on the right, tied in the first heat with this man, Jan Verber of the Czech Republic, and his brakeman, Jan Stuklaska. It's unlikely that they'll be tied at the bottom. Who will have the better second heat?
You know, these first two sleds, we noticed the athletes aren't quite as big, not quite as massive. We just talked about the maximum weight of the sled going down the hill with the athletes. Well, the athletes aren't as big, they have to add weight to the sled, and that means they have to push a heavier sled. And that takes a toll on their start time, and that's just hard to compete when you have to push a heavier sled.
It's interesting that Jan Verber is driving what seems to be the sled that was used by another athlete in the first heat, Milan Janišák of Slovakia. Well, it's got start draw number 21, and Jan Verber was start draw number 19. So we'll wait and see exactly what happens about that. It certainly had Janišák's name on the handle. Seems to have his livery now. I have to look back in our tape ops to see what Verber was driving in the first heat, whether it was in fact this sled. 123.5, not bad speed, but again, we will see faster.
Started to lose his lead a little bit. It was up to 0.2. Now he's lost it. He's got back to second place by 0.04 of a second.
There you go. 0.04 between two sleds on 2,800 meters of ice. Not much between them at all. That's a couple of inches. So Jan Verber pops out.
See the difference between skeleton. Again, we talked about the start time. A 5:27 start isn't real competitive with some of the top sleds. These athletes are kind of a little skinnier, and you can't expect them to be as strong as some of the top teams. Gets pretty high coming through shade. You can see how the left side of the sled almost touches the lip, touches that top wall in the middle of that big left, excuse me, that big right-hand curve.
Interesting. Jan Stuklaska may well just be on borrowed equipment for these North American races with his sled back home. Next up, we get to Nikita Zakharov of Russia. Three Russian sleds started the first heat. Only two remain because the second Russian sled was disqualified for being overweight. And of course, Russia holds the next Olympic Games in February 2014. You know, we are 18 months out and counting. They're getting disqualified for really basic stuff, and they haven't got starts either as well. The Russians are in all sorts of trouble. I don't think the Canadians were this much of a disarray 18 months out of Vancouver.
Yeah, both the women's program and the men's program feeling a lot of pressure from the government, from the organizing committee of the Olympics. They really need to step it up if they plan on fulfilling those expectations.
Zakharov, World Cup rookie, 5:30 first heat, 5:31 in the second.
A little slower. If you notice the brakeman, Maxim, in the back of that sled, he's got huge, wide shoulders. You can see it right there as a great angle. He almost is a little too high because he kind of acts like a sail. It's just not real aerodynamic to have a guy with that broad of shoulders in the back of the sled.
Somehow they got to get him to bend over a lot more. You know, the taller you get, the harder that becomes because, of course, your head is then in the back of the driver, and can't be more irritating things than having your brakeman's head banging off your shoulders or off your helmet.
Yeah, his lead was up to 900, now down to 200 of a second.
That's all gone. 123.5, only the same as Jan Verber, but it certainly rattled all the walls through the chicane.
And that lead is now gone. He slipped back to third place so far.
He'll drop to the bottom of the top 20. Can't drop out. 56.94 slide. He came down 56.68, so that was considerably worse second time down than it was the first. And as you see, his brakeman is about a foot too wide to get into that sled, isn't he?
Yeah, he has to get out of the sled sideways to get in there.
And that means, of course, he has to get in sideways as well.
Yeah, that's right. You see, just bouncing around, coming through the chicanes, and again, you can see how high that brakeman is riding. Where we looked at Jürgen Loacker and the Austrians, you couldn't see his brakeman at all.
He's an absolute bull, Maxim Melyshkin. There is his driver, Nikita Zakharov. If something breaks out, you want to be stood right behind Melyshkin, because he'll stop a lot. Well, now, here's a great story. A brand new driver on the World Cup scene, Loïc Costaigne from France, started his World Cup campaign with a 17th fastest slide. Romain Heinrich behind him, his rookie brakeman as well. And if he can put another tidy run together, he could end up in the top 15, potentially. There's your leader, Jürgen Loacker. Yeah, you can get dressed. Carry on. It's cold out. Let's not get a chill. Bad enough the announcers are ill. Don't want the athletes getting it as well.
Now, the first three sleds we've seen in the second heat, none of them were able to improve their start time at all. Being a young driver and kind of a starting from scratch program as the French are, you'd like to see them really get their start time in to be competitive with the rest of the top leaders.
5:30, 20th fastest start, 5:32. Just wondering maybe whether they might loosen up a little bit into the second run, knowing they got into the race because they started outside the top 20 in the first heat. He's loosening up a little too much. Big skids there.
Yeah, came in a curve three, took a tap that you'll see all the sleds do, but then it sent him into a skid and went in sideways, and that's not what the top sled
do. He's only 700s up on Jürgen Loacker, and he's gone behind now, but if he can tidy it up, good exit from Shady, that wasn't bad.
Got on curve 11, nice and early. We'll see if that gives him good speed through the chicanes.
Not good enough, I'm afraid. He's the slowest so far. Don't forget, he can't drop out of the top 20. He has dropped to the back of the field. Little loose second run. He did all the work in the first heat, though. Tucks his head to the line. 57.26. That's over half a second slower than his first heat, and those mistakes at the top kind of confirmed that was always likely to happen.
Yeah, even his start time that wasn't spectacularly good, he lost a lot of speed as he came out of curve three way at the top, went into those sideways skids. Here, I think coming out of curve 14 in the chicanes, you can see he hits the left wall early. And it's just really hard to steer a sled as it's going through a flat surface. You need to be able to steer in the curves so that you can set yourself up to go straight when it is flat.
Well, listen, that French crew, their first ever World Cup start. They made the race in a field of 27 sleds. Only 20 go through into the second heat. So job number one for them for the rest of the season is going to be make the cut. They started off the best way possible. Now, Switzerland's Martin Gallica with Abraham Morlu behind him, the Swiss two sled. Injury problems for their number one and number two drivers means that the Swiss are really on the back foot at the beginning of the season. There's no Beat Hefti, no Gregor Bauman. Great leg speed from Abraham Morlu, the brakeman, really trying to heft it off the line.
Fast turnover, fast, smooth load, that's pretty good. 5:23 start time.
Okay, for this end of the top 20, that's a pretty decent start, but it's not going to worry too many of the top line crews. Gallica, I don't know the last time he was on Lake Placid, but it's got to be a few years ago.
He's looking pretty smooth. He's got a nice even flow as he comes through curve 5, 6, and 7.
Avoid the walls on the way down.
Slowly extending his lead, yeah, 34 to 3500.
Top speed there. He hasn't got one of the new Swiss Citius sleds with their distinctive angled noses. This is an old style Hans Hiltebrand sled and none the slower through the air for it. Not a bad slide, 56.69. His first was a 56.59.
You know, his lead was really extending as he got through the midpoint of the track. He was up to 3500ths of a second. But he only finished with a lead of 2/10 of a second. So somewhere in the bottom, somewhere in the labyrinth or the chicanes, he lost a little bit of that speed.
Well, listen, we've got three US sleds in the top five positions after the first heat of this two-man race. Earlier on today, we had two US sleds on the podium. Jasmine Fenlater in second place behind Olympic champion Kaylee Humphries. Alana Myers in third. And all three break women were rookies. On the left, Lola Jones. And on the right-hand side, Tiana Madison. Two summer London Olympic athletes. Recruited by US bobsleigh, so really producing the goods. A great day already for the US bobsleigh program.
Yeah, there was a lot of green on that podium, you know, just not a lot of experience. But, you know, as the couple years go by and as the 2014 Olympics get closer, you know, that experience will grow.
You know, those two girls, and indeed, Chelsea Volwa behind Kaylee Humphries, could only get quicker, right? They'll get stronger. Future is bright. Now, what about Canada? This is Justin Cripps. We've got two Canadian sleds here, 14th and 15th. Disappointing first runs for both. 5.19 getaway. They both started top 10 starts. It all just kind of went downhill from there.
Yeah, Cripps has is one of his strengths and his driving, or excuse me, one of his competition is his start. Justin Cripps is a great athlete. He was a really strong push athlete, so he's hoping to carry that over. Just like we talked about on the women's side, you use that great start and just try to hold on to that lead. 5.18 and a 5.19 is start times. That lead is slowly slipping away.
It's going to be fractions of a second in it, only 400s in front of Gallica. Good run through the chicane, not quite as quick, but much cleaner. And that should just help him extend those numbers in the green. Not by much, 600s of a second. Clean to the line, we'll put him into the lead. Yes, 56-63 slide.
Yeah, that was an interesting run because his lead was slowly slipping away, but somewhere through curve 10, 11, 12, he was able to reduce his mistakes and was able to move up on Gallagher and was able to then extend his lead to 1,300s.
Well, he's had the fastest start so far in the second heat, 5.19.
Pretty good by Ben Coquill on the back end of the sled. You know, when he launches off that block, most of his energy was going horizontal, just like you like it. Not a real high heel recovery.
Look at the speed. One of the, in fact, I think now the only male bobsleigh driver to still compete in goggles. Nevertheless, shoots the chicane third through the speed traps. Well, there is Cripps. And the Movember look is growing nicely on the faces of the Canadian athletes, as it will be too in this team. With Chris Spring and Ben Coquill. Justin Cripps with rookie brakeman Jean-Nicolas Carrière behind him. Coquill, another new name to me. There are your leads. So Canada will lead after this. But will it be Canada 3 or Canada 2? Well, Chris Spring returning at the beginning of the World Cup season. After a promising start last year, big crash in Germany left the whole crew in hospital in the four-man wreck. It's taken them a long time to recover. Still not back to his fastest best. 5.20 first heat, 5.20 again there in the second heat, Kurt.
Yeah, you haven't seen anybody really improve on their start time from the first heat to the second heat, which, you know, even though it's colder temperatures, you know, makes you wonder if the ice is a little more beat up. We had the skeleton third heat in between the heats of the bobsled race, so that might cause a little bit of deterioration in the ice.
We reckon there's going to be 99 trips down the ice today. We've got one Russian excluded, so 98, but we've only got 14 left. So, yeah, there's been a lot of trips away from those blocks, no question.
Yeah, this track crew is working very hard, but they just don't have time to spray a fresh spritz of ice on the track.
124.4, good speed as well. He's the quickest man through that speed trap. Good slides further down the track. It was a little scrappy at the top for Chris Spring. Wow, that's a decent run, 56.50, but again, first heat, 56.35, so nobody's approaching their first run times yet. A couple of mistakes in the first couple of corners.
Now, this big right-hand curve, we call it Curve Shady 2. It's curve number 10 on the track. You can make a lot of mistakes coming out of Curve Shady, coming into Curve 11. And you want to be on the right side so you can get into Curve 11 nice and early. And Chris does a good job of riding that big wave through there.
Once again, stick around for the 4:30 award ceremony. A lot of world champions, a lot of Olympians,
Spring,
some world
untidy at the top. Better down at the bottom where the speeds are higher. If you're going to hit the wall in a car, you want to do it at a lower speed. In a bobsleigh, you want to do it at the highest speed possible because it costs you correspondingly less. There is Chris Spring, but the real mountain man look going on. He's our race leader. Well, Beat Hefti, not here competing in the World Cup. The World Cup champion in two-man last year, slid two-man exclusively for Switzerland, wouldn't take part in the four-man. But he is on the sick list. And as a result, the number one Swiss sled is last year's number two stroke number three, Rico Pater. And an opportunity, but Kurt, on the flip side of that, of course, there's a lot of pressure carrying Switzerland one, your nation's best hopes.
Yeah, with Beat having the Lake Placid flu, we like to call it, you know, gives an opportunity to some of the other drivers, and they might not get many more opportunities like this, so they need to capitalize.
Stephen Friedley behind him. Let's see what he can produce. 5:22 first start, 14th in the field. 21, so right in there again, within a hundredth or so. That's as close as you're ever going to get.
Yeah, he's got to be pretty pleased with that start compared to the first heat. Now he just has to hold that start. And that's not going to do it, that big back-end skid coming out of curve three.
Very distinctive look to his sled, the Citius program that the Swiss have, high-tech company that's developing these sleds. Very angular look to the front of it, different from Martin Gallagher's more traditional cigar-shaped looking sled.
Even though that skid coming out of three, he's been able to hold a 200th of a second lead really high out of curve 12. Now he's tied.
Desperately trying to hang on. 1:23.6, not as fast as Chris Spring. He's not got enough juice in the tank, surely, to stay in front of the Canadian. This could be 15, 18 hundredths behind by the line because you're going uphill to the finish. Tucks his head. It's 11 hundredths of a second, but Spring stays in front. Moves up to no lower than 13th spot.
Well, that's really tough because the only major clear mistake that he made was coming out of the exit of curve 12. He was really high off there. And by here, he'd already lost a little speed. Curve 14 into the chicanes. And this also just added to the loss of time.
1:23.6 through there. And the Canadians who lead 1:24.4 kilometers an hour. Getting up to 78 miles an hour. Simone Battazzo of Italy lying in 12th place after the first heat. And he is a 10th of a second away from a 4th place finish. So that is some challenge, but can he make up that kind of ground? Chris Spring leads from Rico Pater and Justin Cripps. 12 to go in our 20-1 rundown. I got it. Well, the Italians, anything short of a major disaster here now will be a way better start to the season than they had last year. Just all sorts of problems. Started with a hamstring tear for Simone Battazzo into the first weekend. And as you know, as an athlete, when you've got this hurry up where you're competing every week, you just can't rest.
Yeah, there's little time for recovery in between races and even less time for recovery for a driver who has to practice and push every day. For a push athlete, sometimes you can take a few days off and let another athlete hop in the back of the sled for you. But Simone didn't get much of a chance to rest last year. So hopefully this year he can be a very consistent driver through this year and just be healthy throughout the entire year.
Second World Cup weekend at La Plagne, France. He had to sit in at the start while he was pushed by the crew. And then in the four-man, he had a crash that sent him straight through the finish area and up the concrete ramp outside. So, yeah, things could hardly have got worse. 0.05 of a second the lead at the moment. Pulled a few more out in their start, but can he hang on? 0.03, going to be very close.
Yeah, he was only 0.04 ahead of Peter Rico coming into this heat. Pretty decent speed, 1:24.1.
That's quicker than the Swiss sleds, but it's Chris Spring who he needs to try and stay in front of. Still 0.03 of a second. It's a tiny margin, 0.04, 56.53. So top 12 finish guaranteed for the Italians. Wow. Well, we said how close this field was from 2 to 10, 2/10 of a second, and from 10 down to 16, just another couple of tenths of a second.
Now, even though he had a decent start time for what he was expecting, the difference can be lost here between curve 2 and curve 3. You can see how he came into curve 3, takes that tap on the left side. But then right here into 4, you can see how the sled was kind of at an angle, and he was going into the track with the back end of the sled on a lower angle than what the top end of the sled would be.
We've seen a lot of sliders coming off 3 and skidding away first, but he got it later on the straight. Ivo de Bruyn made his World Cup debut, and a really impressive slide it was into 11th place for this young Dutch hopeful. The Netherlands two sled seems to be going very strongly indeed. Nikki Minicello, women's bobsleigh world champion on this track a few years back. She is coaching the Dutch setup.
Now, I was expecting and hoping that Ivo was going to do well in this race, and what he really excelled in was the start. A 5.11 start, the first heat was the third fastest. And a 5.12 here, that'll definitely be in the top few starts as well.
Well, we talked about this in heat one, didn't we? Any coach, you give him a fast athlete, he'll love that. Get him to smooth up and hit less things on the way down. He's trying to get a quick driver to become a quick athlete. That's the tricky part.
Yeah, he wants to use that velocity and just kind of hold it through the first few curves and get down the rest of the track. A little skid out of curve two. But for the most part, that's a pretty decent bottom. And he held that lead. He went from 12 hundredths of a second at the first 50-meter mark to 21 hundredths of a second into curve 10.
Listen, this is a tough driver's track where the start isn't quite such a big element of it. What about next weekend in Park City with his kind of starts, third fastest in the field? He could really set the place on fire.
Exactly, and that's what the program is hoping for. You know, the rumor is that the Sochi track is going to depend on a great start time, and that's setting him up well to do well to the 2014 Olympics.
Well, that he started his first World Cup race with an 11th fastest run. He could end up in the top 10. It needs the tiniest of errors from somebody in front, and he will produce a World Cup result to really think about. Couple of mistakes, but when you've got speed at the start, I guess you can afford them.
Yeah, right here in the middle of the labyrinth, you saw that the exit out 11 into 12, from 13 now into 14. Just kind of, honestly, just a little bit all over the shop. Nothing really clean, but for the most part, that's pretty good for Ivo. And he hasn't done many competitive races here in North America, but really did well today.
Great looking orange and black Dutch sled. The Dutch lead with 10 to go from Italy, Canada, and Switzerland. We'll decide our gold medals in the next 20 minutes.
Also check out the Lake Placid Olympic Sports Complex Facebook and Twitter pages. You can follow some of our athletes through the season. Check out all the upcoming events here at the Olympic venues. We've got the top 10 sleds coming up next, so stick around, cheer on our sliders. And then the exciting award ceremony begins at 4:30.
Top 10 sleds getting set up at the top of the hill. And of course, the reverse start order means that the faster sleds in the first heat are starting in these last 10 sleds. So again, although anything can happen, in theory, we are going to see some changes in the current top 10 as our faster sleds from the first heat come down. But you know, no guarantees, anything can happen. But currently leading, Netherlands 2, Italy 1 in second place, and then Canada 2 bringing in right now, that third position.
Once again, we still have a three-way tie for sixth place. I'm sure, I don't think we'll see that happen after run number two. Tight racing yet to come. 20 curves, a mile-long track. Coming down to the hundredth of a second.
Welcome back to Lake Placid, Mount Van Hovenberg in the Adirondack Mountains. We are halfway through the deciding heat of race one in the bobsleigh season opener. Well, there you can see our brake man, and with his head down, our driver of the leading crew, Ivo de Bruyn, and Broer van der Zijde. And an impressive getaway from them. Third fastest starts in the first heat to run 11th. They lead with 10 to go. Martin Haven and American Olympian Kurt Thomasevich. Kurt, Big start from that Dutch crew, and they show that that still has its part to play, even though this is such a driver's track at Lake Placid.
Yeah, there's not much of a break between curve 4 through curve 14 here for the drivers. They're steering nonstop. But if you can get a good getaway, get a good launch off that starting block, you know, that's going to give you a little bit of a head start.
We've got some very big names here lingering at the bottom of the top 10. Max Arndt, Germany 2. Alexander Zubkov comes up next, and then Manuel Mahata, the former World Cup champion. 5:23 getaway. He was 100th in front of the Dutch. He's just given them a 10th in their back pocket.
Yeah, I was a little bit disappointed for the German in their start time in the first heat, but you know, it's a consistent. They were 5:22 the first heat, 5:23 the second heat. So whatever they're doing it consistently, I guess.
And consistently slowly. The sleds built by FES. I was just taking into Matthias Hupfner earlier. These are the sleds that they introduced a couple of years ago, and they're looking to introduce a new sled maybe later this season with a view to what they are going to discover about Sochi, the Olympic track for February 2014. 124Ks, that's a good speed, but he's still losing time. Now he's starting to close on Dutch number two sled. Oh,
wow. Just back 0.02 of a second ahead of him. Wow, that's impressive. You can see that number two on the front of his sled. That's not necessarily a start order, but that's his rank from last year's World Cup. So having a low number like that, you would expect him to be higher than in 10th place. So he's really looking to move up from 10th place, you know, and break into that tie for 6th place.
He was only 100th in front of De Bruyne. That would have been a big scalp for the young Dutch rookie to claim. And you know what? There's a couple more that could happen. De Bruyne was just 400s behind 8th.
Tight times here as we get set up for Alexander Zubkov.
Well, good speed from Chris Spring. Not bad from Max Arndt. What about coach Christoph Langen?
His body language almost says everything. Whether you understand German or not, you know if the Germans are having a good run or a bad run just by his reaction.
Well, Max Hubenbecker there, the giant on the back of Max Arndt's sled. Marco Hubenbecker on back of Max Arndt's sled. A little underwhelming, Arndt, I think. And Alexander Zubkov, Russia's hope for a gold medal in Sochi. A little underwhelming, too. And the cap in the back, Pierre Luders, he's going to have to do some work to get Russia into a winning situation. Well, there's your leaders, 9 to go. Don't forget, Ivo De Bruyne of the Netherlands in second place. Zubkov could drop out of the top 10. He was only in it by 0.03 of a second after the first heat.
Zubkov really drives this track well. Usually does well. He's got great equipment, but honestly, just a lot of bad luck. We talked about it in the first heat, but you know, he was disqualified last year at the World Championships because of a weight problem. So he's Russia's last chance now to kind of save face in this two-man competition.
Well, the Russian number two sled was disqualified in the first heat as well. Zubkov starting to motor away a little bit now from Germany too. There's a maximum and a minimum weight limit that you have to have your sled and crew between. And it's not always as easy as you might imagine.
Not the smoothest exit out of curve 12, kind of up amongst the waves there.
So, do you know what? It's a pretty ugly ride. 123.2 is not great speed. I'm not sure he's going to have a lot in hand through the heart.
He's losing that lead fast.
Yeah, Max Arndt might move up. Ivo De Bruyne might move up.
Tie.
Ooh, tie for the lead. 56.52 slide. He came down 56.18 in the first heat. That was ugly.
Yeah, one major mistake somewhere in the labyrinth, I think, or at the exit of Shady, somewhere in there that really cost him a good start or a good time downtime, because he would have the lead by 0.18 of a second going into curve 10. But it just started to drain away after that.
He's punching the air with delight here. What's going on? I wouldn't be happy with that if I were him.
Well, you can get to really picky and look at the top at the start here. You know, they're pushing that sled. A lot of extra body movement. Look at the brakeman kind of bob his head from side to side. You want all your motion, all as much motion as possible to be in your legs moving horizontal. That extra motion in the head from side to side just doesn't cut it.
We've got a tie for the lead. Now, coming up next, we've got three sleds who are all tied for sixth position. And they were only 100th faster than Zubkov. How many are we going to get tied for the lead here? We could have a five-way tie.
Yeah,
it's unlikely.
We expected this race to be close in a number of different ways, and it didn't disappoint so far.
Manuel Mahata with Christian Poser behind. really trying to motor this one off. They started 5:22, giving away a tenth to the Russians. 5:20, that's a little better, but only a little better.
Yeah, he has improved his start time by 200ths of a second. And that's the most improvement so far we've seen of any of them.
Still, you don't expect to see a Germany 1 crew giving away nearly a tenth to a Dutch rookie. They're just not starting fast enough, the Germans.
One thing that Mahata can do is drive. He does that very well. But it's always kind of been a question in my mind how he can drive with glasses. You'd see most drivers, when they have some kind of corrective lenses, that they would use contact lenses so they can avoid any type of fogging or any kind of problems with glasses. But Manuel wears the glasses underneath that visor and seems to be able to use that to his advantage.
Well, Mahata is pulling away fast. This is a much better run for him, 56.32. Well, it's, the first was ugly, just really uncomfortable. That's a much better run. He's the only slider that we have in the field in glasses. But that's not the only face furniture that he's sporting this month either. You wait till you take a look at this. I say, old boy, how lovely.
Again, we just talked about how the Russians were using so much of that side movement in the upper body.
Ugly, ugly load. Mahata barely made it in.
Takes him way too long to get in that sled. And a lot of times when you take that much time, you're going to come out of those start grooves. And that means you're just kind of free-falling without having a handle on those D-rings.
Well, I always say it's like ice skating. It looks easy until you see somebody slip. And then you realize, oh, hang on a minute, it's sheet ice they're sprinting on. Oh, yeah, that's right. Tied for six then. Manuel Mahata, Edwin van Kalker of the Netherlands, and Lyndon Rush of Canada, who'll come up next. Mahata is our solo race leader from Alexander Zubkov and Max Arndt, Mahata's teammates. Well, what about van Kalker? We've got a Dutchman in fourth place now. Surely van Kalker's got to go quicker than De Bruin, his young rival. He can't give away a quarter of a second, or can he?
Well, he's had a much more experience than his teammate Ivo, but both of them, great start times. 5:11 last heat for De Bruin. Van Kalker, 5:13 last heat. We'll see what they can do this second heat.
Dutch sleds, third and fourth away from the blocks. You've got to like that.
Again, we talked about Sebring's big, long legs. Sometimes it's hard to get into the sled, but he did it fairly smoothly there in 5:09 start time. That's a major improvement over the first heat.
Oh, boy. That's the quickest start of the competition. That's the quickest start we've seen all day here.
His lead's extended to 1/16 of a second. That's saying something over Mr. Mahata.
Yeah, don't forget Manuel Mahata put in a good second run. 1800s, here we go.
The tricky part of the track through the labyrinth into curve 12. Fairly smooth through there. Losing a little bit of a time though.
1100s of the advantage came from the start, 1:23.6 to 1:24.5 of Mahata. This is going to be very close indeed at the line. Will the Dutch sled stay in front? 600s, one corner left to go.
It's going to be hard to keep any lead going up in that curve 19:20 uphill. Yep, loses that lead by 2/100ths of a second.
Well, Manuel Mahata still not guaranteed a top six finish here because we still have six sleds to go. Mahata leads, Netherlands in second. Germany third, Russia fourth, Netherlands fifth. This has got to gladden your heart while you're watching, not while you're competing against them.
Yeah, you see Sebring, how he has to, with those long legs, he has to really dip his shoulders into the sled a little more because his knees just can't drop into the sled like all the shorter athletes can.
Well, you talked about Nikita Zakharov. His brakeman, Maxim Melishkin, is about as wide as he is tall. Sebring is straight up and down. He's got much less shoulder to fit in. So if the knees are in, the rest follows.
That's right. You can see his shoulders a little bit, but with that kind of height, he's not going to be able to bury himself at the bottom of the sled.
Well, kind of like Charles Barkley. He's a long guy, isn't he, to get folded in. There's Mahata offering his congratulations to van Kalker. Or vice versa. Now, Lyndon Rush, he was a three-way tie man with Mahata and van Kalker for sixth spot. CFL footballer Jesse Lumsden on the back handles. They started 5:16 handles out into turn one.
Yeah, you can see that he had that handle out just a little bit too long, and as he went into curve one, that back end of the sled kind of skid up. And that just is kind of telling me that he might not have had a solid grasp on the D-rings because he was worried about that push bar being out in the air.
But just up inside the cowl, just in front of the driver's chin, there's a little lever. It'll have a tab on that you hit with your thumb. That's supposed to release the handle to snap back in. Supposed to, being the operative word. 9 times out of 10, 99 out of 100, maybe it'll do it. Of course, when you're in a deciding race, that'll be the time when it doesn't go in straight away.
Didn't seem to bother his starting velocity too much. He extended his lead to 900s, but now it's only down to 400s of a second. 124.1, pretty decent speed, but this is going to be pretty close.
77.1 miles an hour. Not as quick, though, and he's gone behind Mahata. Mahata's going to break this three-way tie by staying in front of both of his rivals. 56.41 slips behind Van Kalker. Lyndon Rush is third. Coach Graham Richardson there not overjoyed with that.
You always want to cross the finish line and see that number one ranking, but you can see him ask what rank is what he was right there. Just couldn't believe he had that third-place rank there.
So he drops in, his left hand goes in, hits the tab, nothing happens. He's waiting to steer, has to take his hands off the steering handles, hit the tab, until it goes in.
And just a tiny bit of a back-end skid. It wasn't quite as big as I thought so when we first saw it in live action.
You can see lights on the way down to the chicane now.
Hi, Amelia. See you in a couple weeks.
Yeah, back in Whistler 2 weeks from now. Meanwhile, now we get into the thick of the action for the US fans here and on Universal Sports. Corey Buttner, Nick Cunningham, and Steve Holcomb, all three US sleds in the top five. It's not beyond the bounds of possibility. We could sweep the podium here with US sleds. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. We've got a few things to do first.
Yeah, definitely. He's only 400s behind third place. Less than a tenth of a second behind second place.
It is so close. Nobody's going to catch Holcomb unless he gives it to them. But as I said, from second to tenth was 2/10 of a second. Stuff happens on bob tracks.
Definitely. And Corey has the potential to do it. He beat Nick Cunningham in our national team race a few weeks ago, in the two-man race anyway. So, a little stuck there.
Yep.
Foot got stuck in the D-rings, caused him to go left a little bit.
Wow, and that's a shame. 5:16, just the same as their first start. As we talked about, Charles Berkeley at the back there trying to fold himself in. Now, is that going to rattle Corey?
We'll see right here at the next split whether that little mistake cost him. Yeah, and they went from 1/100 of a head at the 50-meter mark to only 800s now. But Corey's been down this track a number of times, so hopefully he has a couple tricks up his sleeve as he goes through curve shady. Yeah, and he's extended the lead to 1/100 of a second.
He's not worrying about Mahata. He's fifth. He wants third at worst, doesn't he? That's what it's all about, being on the podium. This is his best chance of the season.
Very good chicane straight through there. 124.9 kilometers an hour. It's looking good for Corey.
His sled he calls Shiva, one of the Hindu gods, omnipotent and the slayer of foes. 1400s is the lead, 56.25. No worse than a top five finish to kick off Corey Buttner's World Cup campaign. And great exposure as well for the charity that is registered on the sled, Autism Speaks. A lot of support here at home for Corey and for Chuck.
Corey, a younger driver, but really handled himself well in this tough situation. Seems struggled to get into that sled. He actually has to use the push bar twice to get himself into that sled. And you can see that push bar just nicked the left side of the ice, hit the wall as it was coming down. But by the time he gets down to the chicanes, he's really made up for it. Top speed so far.
Well, we may not see many sleds getting up any quicker than that. Just the one. Ryan Scheimer, the coach there in a hat, really liking that run. And Corey should too as well. God, look at guys like you and Charles. I think, how do you get into these sleds? It's just not right. Francesco Friedrich, Germany's only representative in the top five. This is Germany 3, the young rookie, with Gino Gerhardi behind him. Again, another name I don't think has started a World Cup race in two-man.
Now, unlike the other two German sleds, Francisco did have a good start time the first heat, 5:13 first heat, 5:14 the second heat. But he's only 1/100 ahead of Corey coming into this.
That's got to be why he's Germany 3. He's in the team because he can start and drive. You don't get in without ability to Germany. 500s is the lead over Corey Buttner. But will the Americans' bottom half, which really came on strong, help him overturn this German challenge.
Even right now. Tide coming out of Curve Shady. This is going to be close. 200s behind. This is where Corey really did well, and he had a great chicane, so we'll see how Frederick does right here.
Not
a couple
fast.
Taps, a little slower. Looks like Corey's going to move up to at least fourth place.
Yeah. That podium is dangling tantalizingly close. I'm not sure that Friedrich is going to get there. He doesn't. 56.35. That's a tenth of a second slower than the man he was trying to stay in front of. Christoph Langen looks at the screen with disdain. There will be no German sled on the podium here today. Well, nevertheless, Germany 3, first World Cup race here in Lake Placid, beats his established teammates, and they're no fools.
That's true. I mean, Germany 1, 2, and 3, that number really is pretty arbitrary. Germany is always competitive. You know that they're going to be in the mix tomorrow, regardless how they finished here today.
Well, he had good lines. Corey Buttner, though, lost a little bit of ground with that start problem. And the man from Saxony just couldn't hold on at bottom of the track.
This is the heart section of the curve, where it come out of curve 17 nice and long, and you want a smooth transition over into curve 18. And Frederick does that pretty well, but for the most part, he had already lost a lot of time coming into that. He was just a little bit slower than Buttner.
There you can see receiving advice from René Spies, a man who's forgotten more about driving two-man sleds than a lot of drivers will ever learn. Now we're into the meat of it. USA lead with Corey Buttner. And we have two US sleds in the last three. I said it's possible. It's definitely possible that the USA could fill all three podium spots. Now the question is, yeah, has it ever happened? That is a good call. Good. Nick Cunningham is next up. Well, Cunningham, USA 2. Good start from him as well in the first heat. 5.18, so there's so little to choose between these two young American hopefuls.
Yeah, I'm excited to see how this push time comes about, because Andreas in the back of that sled, once again, a really strong athlete and pretty quick as well, but this is his first World Cup race. A little stumble coming in, like he kicked the bunk, but you know, for the most part, that's not going to affect the velocity too bad. 5.14, that's an improvement over their first heat. So 5.18 to 5.14, hopefully Nick, he's a little bit better four-man driver than two-man driver. He can hold that lead here.
He was 400th in front of Corey Buttner from the first heat. He's got 100th in hand.
It's going to come down to equipment and driving ability.
Yes, it is. The National Guard sled is trying to hang on here. 200th of a second in it. One good steer could put him right back in front.
That's true. If he's smooth out of 12, through 14, if he hits the chicane nice and smooth, 124.7, just a hair bit slower than Buttner was.
He could end up in second place in front of Francesco Friedrich, but at the moment he is slipping a little.
100th ahead of the German right now for second place.
Oh,
drops back
fourth
a few
spot
places.
At the line. That's a shame for Nick Cunningham. 56.44. Nevertheless, yeah, there goes my money on the all-US podium. It was just thrown in there, but Cunningham very disappointed with that, as you can see.
But the good news is Corey moves up into at least third place, so he's going to be pretty happy with that.
There you go.
There's a little bit of a skid coming out of curve two into curve three, and that killed a little bit of that start velocity.
And again sends him just slightly offline into the next corner. And that's one of the secrets here on this track, is that no corner stands on its own. It comes off or leads onto another one.
Yeah, it's a chain reaction all the way down from curve four through curve 14. You finally get a chance to breathe once or twice before curve 17, but you know, it's a very connected track.
USA lead with Corey Buttner, two to go. Now, Oscars Melbardis and Dalman Striskins, fastest starters in the field in the first heat, 5.02, a hundredth of a second away from a nine-year-old track record.
We've seen a few teams, not very many, improve their start time from the first heat to the second heat. I'm hoping the Latvians can do that here and get that start record. 5.05, did it!
Yes!
Awesome.
Wow, 5.0. Well, coaching is Pierre Ludis, Giulio Zardo. We haven't seen him at a track for a long while. It's a new start record for the Latvians, but it's rocky at the top of the track.
A little bit of a skid already out of curve two, and you know, with that big start time and that huge lead that they have right now, they want to just, you know, minimize the number of skids, stay off the walls, and just hold that lead coming through the curves.
2,500s up, 3,400s up, now back down to 2,200s. He's giving away speed, big skids. He can't handle the speed. Nobody can handle this speed. Nobody else carries this speed.
Yeah, he lost that lead from 3,400s per second. That lead is already gone. 121.9 is horrendous.
3K's too slow. My goodness. What a start, but not a great finish. He is going to drop down the order. We are going to have a US 1-2.
Wow,
Corey Butner, fifth in the first heat. Grimace from Sanders Prusis. But this is what he needs. We talked about this before. What was your phrase? About having a quick driver?
That's right. You can't... You need to take athletes and turn them into bobsledders is a lot easier than turning an athlete into a bobsledder. So what they're doing right now is giving them a huge start, that start record of 5 flat. But, you know, you just got to hold on to that lead and minimize the mistakes going down. And he did not do that.
Well,
right,
listen,
out of curve two,
yeah,
skidding already.
And he knew it as well. But, you know, he's carrying more speed away from the start than anybody has ever carried on this track. Perhaps not a surprise he can't handle it. He's only in his third year as a driver.
Yeah, you can see even there out of curve 12, he just kind of falls off the curve and doesn't drive it smoothly into curve 13.
I tell you what, he's going to be a threat come Park City next week. He knows he let it drift away, but that don't matter. He's got the potential. Now then, we are going to have an American winner to our season opener here in Lake Placid. Whichever way you slice it, that's going to happen, because Corey Butner leads and Steve Holcomb is the last man to go.
Yeah, this is pretty exciting for American bobsled right now.
A 1-2 result here will be a great start to the season. We've already had two US sleds on the women's podium. Away goes Holcomb. 5.10 first start, 5.11 in the second. But he's got a big advantage, over half a second from the first heat over Corey Butner.
Yeah, this lead is up to 5,900ths of a second right now. That's a really speedy, fast sled that they're in right now. Frank Wrigley designed this sled not too long ago using a Bodine body, and they made a couple modifications. And that Dirty Frank sled right now is really flying.
It's got the mean matte black look that Steve has adopted over the last few years. 6,400ths up. He's just creeping away a little.
Nice and smooth out of 12.
Well, he can stop at a shop and pick up a coffee on the way down if he needs to. 124.7, only one sled quicker. You want to guess who it was?
Corey Butner.
Corey Butner is right. 124.7 to 124.9, but Holkey had the moves in the first heat, and he just underlines it here with a massive victory. But it is a US 1-2, a 6-tenths of a second win. He only opened up 6 hundredths over Corey Butner on that second heat. And that tells us two things. First of all, Corey Butner's quick. But secondly, he could have been even quicker.
That's
if he'd
right.
had two runs like the second. And that means as the consistency comes, the speed will be even more of a threat. But gold goes to Holkey and Langton.
The American program hasn't had a whole lot of success in two-man in the last couple of years, but ending last season with the World Championship and starting this season with the gold medal, that's pretty exciting stuff.
Well, a 1-2 combination. It is gold, it is silver, and as at the end of the first heat, all three US sleds in the top five. Nick Cunningham didn't complete the podium sweep, but he wasn't too far away. 6 hundredths quicker from Cunningham, we'd have had a USA 1-2-3. Wow. And we are going where next weekend?
Park City, Utah.
Park City, Utah. Home, baby, for Stephen Holcomb, our World Cup Race 1 winner and points leader. The world champion doesn't seem to have taken much of a backseat over the summer. Well, Steve Holcomb wins the first two-man gold of the season. Last year, he said he was going to try and concentrate a little more on two-man. Seems that the focus hasn't wavered that much going into 2012, 2013. Well, confirmation of the results with three American sleds in the top five. Germany 3 ahead of his teammates in third position. Francesco Friedrich claims his first World Cup medal. Corey Butner takes the silver. Holcomb takes the gold. We'll be back. Welcome back to Lake Placid at the end of a very busy day of sliding at the Olympic Center in Mount Van Hovenberg. And what a day for the USA. Silver and bronze in the women's bobsleigh race. They've gone one better with gold and silver in the men's two-man competition. And it's the man who won the world championship on this track in February in 2 and 4, Steve Holcomb, with Stephen Langton behind him. He led after the first heat. An imperious drive in heat one built the victory, and he sealed it with a comfortable run to the line in the second heat. Last year, he promised to concentrate more on the two-man, and this year, he continues to do the same. So confirmation of the result. Stephen Holcomb, the winner from Corey Butner, his teammate, German rookie Francesco Friedrich on the podium. Down with them is our man, John Morgan.
Okay. Flower ceremony here at the first World Cup of the year in Lake Placid, New York. Ladies giving out the flowers, and we're going to go over to first time ever World Cup medalist. Are you surprised on this result today?
A little bit, but last year World Championships, we was on this track very good, and so it's good two runs we make. And
Good start times too, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, now another first-time medalist here, Corey Butner. You beat Mahada, Zubkov. I mean, your first ever World Cup. Did you dream this last night that this could happen?
I had no idea this would happen. I mean, it's our home track, and it's just happy to be racing here, and got Chuck with me on the brakes, and it's just it's unbelievable today. It's just a good day for us.
Well, you've toiled a long time. Congratulations. Good for you. Steve Holcomb, Steve Langton, good consistent starts. You know, you used to dominate in the four-man by 5 tenths, but in the two-man?
Yeah, well, I mean, this is my home track. I had two great starts with Steve today. When you start out fast, you know, it makes it easy for me. But I think the winner today was Frank Briglia with his sled. It's pretty big.
Listen, good starts then again, but, you know, are you different focus on two-man this year? I mean, you always, you know, the two-man was a warm-up for the four-man.
Yeah, I mean, we've always been in the mix a little bit with two-man, but I think, you know, that's kind of the event that really we struggle in for me personally. So I'm trying to make up for that and hopefully come away with another world championship title or possibly a gold medal next year at the Games in two-man. So.
Well, the last three events in FIBT bobsledding, you won them all. Congratulations. First event of the year.
Last US 1-2, incidentally, in two-man was here in Lake Placid. John Napier beat Steve Holcomb. The next day, they went 1-2 the other way round in the four-man. But Steve Holcomb and here Corey Butner, first and second for the USA. Francesco Friedrich completes the podium for our first World Cup of the year. And that does it for a Friday with 98 trips down the track from all sorts of different sleds at Lake Placid. For Kurt Tomasevich, David Kurtz and John Morgan, for our director Tim Singer, I'm Martin Haven saying thank you for joining us. Don't forget, the four-man race kicks off bright and early, 9 Eastern, 2 GMT tomorrow. Join us then, live.
Testing, test, test, test. Very happy German team down here. Your first medal ever. Did you think a medal was possible?
Yeah, I mean,